All right. Blanche, I'm ready.
Okay, so you're painting Abbey today, huh?
I'm doing Abbey. I'm walking over and doing Abbey.
Well, I'm standing right here where I'm at. I'm in South Ogden. Anyway, I knew Abbey from my father-in-law, and my father-in-law was kind of this pseudo-artist. I don't know what they were, but anyway, they drank like animals. You know, they were all hardcore alcoholics, but they were very conscious people. And I used to hang around with those guys here when I was like in my early 20s. I was an honor student at the U with, Stegner was one of my professors, and I was in that little group, and they were hardcore environmentalists, but he was the hardcore of the hardcore. I think a lot of people don't know about him is without Wallace Stegner taking a chance on him, no one would even know who he is. He, you know, Stegner was dean at the Stanford Writing Guild, you know, that legendary guild of writers. He took a chance on him, and I think Abbey worked on his master dissertation for 20-something years, never finished it. You know, Carol Gallagher says to me all the time, because she knew them both well, too, and she says, Kevin, when are you going to finish that book? And I says, God, I'm going to break Abbey's record, I think. But The Guardian did this beautiful article on Abbey here a while back, and it said he went from the landscape to the library his whole life. Well, that's what I've done my whole life. I spent my whole life in our university library, and you see, I'm outside all the time. I'm never inside. By the way, today is the first day that it's rained here in over 100 days. But he, you know, as far as the man, he was the salt of the earth guy who he could write like no other, but he got it that this soft environmental movement that was starting to happen, clear back then, they were trying to hijack it, well, not hijack it, this, you know, I think it ties really into where Bobby Kennedy was killed and the Democratic Party split in the United States, and they went from progressives to liberals. People forget that the left in this country were meaner than fuck. The Bobby Kennedys, the Shermans, you know, all of them, they were fucking hardcore fuckers, mean. And then the soft took it, and when they took it, they took the environmental movement with them. And Abbey was a counter to that. Now, Abbey, when he wrote the Monkey Wrench name, it was required reading in Utah in the seventh grade. It was required. If he wrote that book today, he would be charged as an eco-terrorist and be put in Supermax. I don't know if anybody, and my favorite character in there is, you know, is Sullivan C. Smith. He was a Mormon who would try to pray that, you know, Hoover Dam. But the university that I hang around at, our university, it was the university that Utah Construction, who built Hoover Dam. So Abbey in his book said he wanted to blow it up, you know, over and over and over, but he was an amazing, brilliant, brilliant man. You look at his quotes, you look at his, I mean, read his books. I mean, wow. But, you know, he was a hardcore alcoholic, but the greatest story ever of Abbey is his death. His group of friends, and I knew these guys, they were counterculture hardcore, including my ex-father-in-law. They were brilliant men. And they were all artists in their own way. And they were all people that were connected with the earth. I mean, they were construction workers and flashers. A lot of them were rock masons. And, you know, they were in symphony with their environment in a hardcore, I mean, they were hunters. They were, you know, these dudes were so, I have this great picture of Abbey with this old beat up 1970 Ford truck with a front end freaking cage. That's what he drove around. I think he was married six or seven times, but when he died, you know, he wanted nothing about this fucking embalming and this whole fucking thing. You know, it gets so much deeper than that, what he's about. But his friends, they loaded him up in a sleeping bag. They took him to the Sonora. By the way, anybody's ever been to the Sonora in Tucson, the desert out there, well, that's what people say he is. Who knows where he's at? They loaded him up in these freaking sleeping baggies, dug a hole, put him in the other, and then got drunk over his body, you know, celebrating. He asked them to do it, and they did it. They did it. You know, my father-in-law's name is Ned, and he says, like, you know, and he was the same way. He says, when I die, just put me right over here in this orchard grove that my great-grandfather's planted, and just put a mark that says, here's Ned, he's dead. And that's the way they were. I mean, there was a lot of Utahns that were that way. A lot of Utahns lived that way, and they were hardcore environmentalists. They took no shit. And if fuckers tried to shove something down their throat, they fought it. They fought it like a war. I mean, they considered it a war. You know, Abbey considered it a war. It is a fucking war. And he hated the soft fucking free huggers. I mean, he fucking hated them with a fucking passion. He was real. I mean, that guy was so real. You know, everybody should read that book. It's like, I did that thing at the wall where I took the ballad of Kid to Christopher, which is one of my best pieces of art I ever did. And I jump over down that shirt that I have on. That's one of Abby's shirts. That's one of the characters out of that book. You know, that's the old ex-nom. These were guys who were all, they were usually all old Korean War guys and all ex-nom guys. You know, a lot of them had freaking frostbite from the Hell's Kitchen. Their toes were missing. You know, this is the type of guys that they understood that war was a fucking scam, that the American, you know, nuclear movement was nothing but profit, or, you know, a death for profit, just like war. They got it. They fucking got it. He was the king. He was the top of it because he could write. And, you know, the thing is, they all wrote. This whole group of alcoholics, you know, and they were all alcoholics. People consider that odd. Oh, they were. Trust me, they were alcoholics. And, you know, for some very good reasons, but they all wrote. They all wrote poetry. They all fucking wrote. They all painted in their own way. They were all amazing art. And they were, a lot of them were rock masons, builders. He was an amazing dude. I tell my daughter when I was in the hospital full of leukemia, I said, listen, I still have the quilt that my grandmother, the Mormon women make these quilts. I still have that quilt from when I was 7. My grandma gave it to me. I still have it. I still sleep in it. And I said, just wrap me up in that quilt and put me here, over here by the edge of the lake, by the marshes, you know, where the blue herons are at, and the ducks and the geese. So, but what colors are you using today?
Well, I'm working with a black and a blue, and I want to get the yellow in it as well. It's the black, blue, and the yellow.
Oh, yeah. That's a great combination of colors for him. I think that would say so much about him. You know, he even go further than nuclearism. He was the predecessor. You think about even, I mean, those guys, you think about what they were back then, they were anti-dams. They were hardcore anti-hydroelectric. You know, they loved the Colorado. I mean, Stedner, and here, our governor in Utah, I call him Dirty Herbie, is trying to put through a nuclear plant on the green. I mean, that was Abbey and Stedner's and, you know, Udall. I always say, where the fuck is his two nephews? They're both United States Senators. They love the fucking Colorado and the green. He's trying to build a nuclear plant on it. Oh, if they were alive today, if Stedner was alive, if Abbey was alive today, oh, fuck, I can imagine. He'd end up in a prison cell, I'm sure. I mean, you think about the things that we did is in the 70s and the 80s, we fought back. And it was accepted to fight back. We didn't allow these fucking pricks to make it unacceptable to fight back. Things that Americans have always done, they have always fought back. That's, we fought against the Queen, the Revolutionary War, you know, used tariffs. I mean, the East India Company, I call the East India Company Walmart. That's what Walmart is. Walmart's the East India Company. That's, you know, that's what the Boston Tea Party. So it was there was nothing more American than to fight back. To fight back intensely on these fucking monsters. Via the kidnapping of the progressive movement, and the liberals went so soft, and you know, that right-wing hairspray, I'm God, using Jesus, and lying motherfuckers. That's always existed, but we fought them. Well, what happened to the other side? I mean, our forefathers developed a beautiful two-party system, but we don't have a two-party system because we don't fight back. It was built to fight back. And so the liberals have become, we've been labeled as soft tree huggers. Can you imagine, Abby? Can you imagine when somebody walking up to that fucker and saying you're a soft creator? He'd crack you across the face with a whiskey bottle.
Okay, listen to me. I'm listening to you talk about this, and I'm thinking about the Braveheart idea. I just realized that, you know, the Braveheart thing was all about the blue, you know, that blue face thing?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm just gonna...
I didn't even think of that. You're right. You know, 700 years ago, and hey, right where I'm standing, that mountain, Ben Lomond Pook, you know, that's the Scottish mountain. Mariner named it. It all ties back to Scotland, so much of this effect. And William Wallace was a real man. And you know what's ironic you bring that up? The guy that I'm talking about, my ex-father and I, you know whose name was?
What?
His middle name was Wallace. And you know he was related, bloodlines, to William Wallace? My brother's right out of William Wallace's bloodline on my, that my wife. She really named it William Wallace, so that's ironic that he bring that up. I didn't even think about that blue face, so get on to it.
That's brilliant.
Totally
that's,
on to it.
Okay, so I'm hitting it on that one. I've got the blue and the black.
Wow, how beautiful. And then you go to the yellow, you know. What, you gonna do the hat yellow, you say, you think?
The what?
You got his hat on him?
I got the hat on him, yeah, I want to do the hat in the yellow. What do you think?
Yeah, because, I mean, we need, like I said, I think that you're right, you got it, and because you got the blue and the black, and then the yellow is so nuclear. But you, another thing, too, about him, he loved flowers, and he loved wildflowers. A lot of people don't know about that. Think about this. There's one, you know, you go back to Van Gogh and the yellow sunflowers. You know, you got to realize how worshipped flowers were in Holland in those days. They were the currency. And, you know, he countered with it. What is the only natural plant on Earth that actually eats man-made nuclear fallout out of the atmosphere? Sunflowers, yellow, black and yellow. I mean, it's so irony that the nuclear industry, what they've done with those colors, and it's going to sit back right in their face. You know, the bumblebee and the sunflower.
You know,
so that's the color that I've been using.
I
love those colors.
The yellow is the most difficult color to paint. I find the most difficult color to paint is the yellow. And there are very few artists. Van Gogh, I said, liberated yellow.
Yeah. That's what his yellow, he was the master of yellow. He's the only guy that's ever been able to master yellow. I use yellow quite often too, and oh, are you right? I mean, I use it with a lot of red, because I like to use a lot of earth tones from here in the desert where I live, where Abby lived here in the desert. By the way, like I said, today's the first time it's rained in over 100 days. I mean, it's so fucking dry, you wouldn't believe it. Heat wave from hell, but yeah, those desert colors, you know, and those desert flowers, by the way, most desert flowers that bloom across this Great Basin Desert, they're yellow. Really beautiful yellow. And people want to fucking kill them. They spray poison all over and kill them and grow fucking grass. And the hideous is green. I'm so sick of looking this fucking fake green, what lawns are. You know, again, I would go at it. He was such a purist. He was so organic. He was so authentic. He was the king. You know, if we had, you know, Tim DeChristopher and people like that try to say, they're like, they're not Abby. They're not even close to fucking Abby. You know, DeChristopher is, boy, he is. I love the kid, but he's no Edward Abbey. Edward Abbey was a fucking artist. I mean, he's in Pennsylvania writing. I mean, you even read his early stuff. And Stegner was so fucking... Stegner could have lived anywhere he wanted, by the way. Another artist. You think about these Stegners, they were artists. Stegner, a lot of people don't know this about Stegner. When he came out of Canada, him and his dad were his little boys. They were stopped in Helena, Montana, the Great Falls, I believe. And he went out and got, you know, mowing people's lawns. He only had like three people with mow lawns. One of them was Charlie Russell, the Western artist. I mean, so these people, they're all artists. And boy, did they get it. Oh, they got it. And they shaped culture. Like I said, that was required reading in the seventh grade here. He goes supermax for that book now. I mean, by the way, it's a little teeny book. You know, I've been reading it to my grandson. It's such a cool
book. What are you reading?
Young people. What's that?
What book are you reading to your grandson?
The Monkey Ranch Gang. They love that book. My little grandson loved that book because it has characters in it, you know, and I skip over the swear words for them, you know?
Yeah. But
I don't know why I do that. You know, they get it from me anyway and everybody else, but they get it, you know? to try to shelter children from the reality is wrong. You know, you've got to shelter them and nurture them from, you know, they really should be nurtured from watching Fox News and these hairsprayed phonies and these plastic females. That's what they should be sheltered from. I mean, that's, look what it's groomed us into. By the way, me and my grandson was watching Sesame Street the other morning. I can remember the first day that it started. I love that. There's still good stuff out there. PBS does great stuff. But these kids are bombarded. I mean, we're bombarded with these newscaster types that talk all night. So the Pacific Ocean is being nuclear destroyed. It's a genocide. Let's check the news. You know, Abbey would flip his fucking lid. I could see him. You know, but what are those guys? Well, you can't do that because we flipped that, we made that against the law. I mean, if you do any of these things even close to what these guys did, this culture has no respect for art, none. The United States has no, the world has no respect for fucking artists. They have no respect for the fucking earth. They have no respect for the fucking Mother Earth whatsoever, none. You know, Cobain's blind. What's Cobain's blind? Nature is a whore in bloom. There's another one who's an environmentalist. People don't know. Kurt Cobain was an environmentalist. You listen to the lyrics, in bloom. You know, people don't know what's in bloom. That's when an animal's in heat. You know, the earth, oh yeah, it's in heat. And nature is a whore. You know, what's going to it? What the fuck? I mean, this is all we have for time and all eternity. And I haven't got it. He wrote about it over and over, but that was in the 70s. So.
Now I'm showing. I'm standing in front of the camera, and you know, as you're talking, I'm realizing that what you and I are doing is it's never been done before. We just briefly talked about this before we started this video, this talk about the fact that what you call social media is extending into our private spaces. You are in your space. I'm in my space. I'm making a painting. We're hooked up together. And your comments are creating, in a way, my painting. And this is...
Well, it's powerful, it's amazing, it's never been done before. I mean, it's so perfect for the information age. The information age is the most powerful thing ever invented in the history of humanity, except for maybe nuclear, you know, on the negative. So you think about it, it's the counter to negative. Negative evil, this is powerful. People are behind the curve on the information age. It is, you know, if people want to use it quirky and goofy, it's not quirky and goofy. You know, doctors are starting to use it. They should have been using it the whole time. Attorneys, you know, the professional type. You know, but as far as information, artists. You know, it's not just digital art. You know, that's what everybody tried to kidnap it as digital art. It's what we're doing right here, right now. It's, like I said, I mean, here I'm in Utah, standing anywhere. I'm standing right out here. It's raining in front of the mighty, beautiful, incredible Wasatch. You're up there in Canada, they're painting, and we're collaborating. What word do you use?
The cooperation.
No collaboration. Get out of collaboration. I forget.
Cooperation.
Fuck collaboration.
Yeah, fuck collaboration because I don't want to be fucked with.
I get you.
Yeah, I don't want to be fucked with in my stuff. I don't want to be meddled with, but I'll cooperate. Yeah. I'll cooperate with you any day, but I don't want to be fucked with my stuff.
And my stuff, you know, as far as post-signers, a lot of people, I invented it on 10-10-10. By the way, I invented it in the same library that Edward Abbey wrote a lot of his stuff. I'm going to write a book about that library. Edward Abbey was in that library all the fucking time, in the same fucking library at the university.
Where's that, Ogden?
In the same post-signer. I invented it in the same place he wrote a lot of his stuff. So I think it's on 10-10-10, and I want people to collaborate with me. Yeah, you know, that's what I say, post ignorance, and I have that big logo, your logo here. Yeah, I may invent it, but it's so much bigger than I will ever be. It's a fucking seed. I want people to take it. I don't want people to profit from them. And I want people to give me credit for coming up with the idea and doing all these fucking videos of mine, calling out Fukushima and this other one. But I want people to run with it. I want them to do whatever they want with it and grow it, especially young people. That video that was tagged by you, by that woman in Scotland, by the way.
She is gorgeous. She's beautiful.
Oh, that video is so perfect. She has nailed post-ignorance. Just, you look at that piece of art she did. It's so alive, so organic, but it speaks. It's metaphor. Boy, does she get my movement. You know, that's what it is. And, you know, go with it. I love it.
Yeah, sure. Her YouTube name is Lorna Too Funky. Lorna Too Funky.
Yeah, it's called Post Fitness Free Radicals. You know, and that's what we're up to. You know, we found each other via the internet. I don't know how, but we were both doing these things before Fukushima happened, both of us.
Yeah.
You know, I used to think, this fucking crazy whacked out fucker up in Canada sends me this shit in the mail and I get this shirt. Why I'm in critical, critical condition, in the hospital, almost dead. And it says, dead man standing. I'm like, I looked at that shirt and I said, either this fucking guy has got a lot of fucking balls and he's a fucking, gotta be some sick motherfucker, or this guy gets it, one of the two. But I started checking this guy out, and it was, you know, you, Thomas Ackermann. I'm like, oh, this guy, this ain't no insult. This, you know, because I get people all the time, ain't you dead yet? You know, people that actually room for me to die because I soberly took chemo and smoked weed away.
That's brutal.
That's
brutal. You're telling me that people actually sent you while you're on your fucking deathbed, they say, why aren't you dead yet?
Yeah, including Chris Buzzard. I said the email.
Oh, fuck.
Now, I guess I intimidated Chris Buzzy somehow, so you should see the email. I had to calm my uncle down. My uncle's, you know, an ex-NFL player, ex-fighter. He's an old man, but meaner fuck. I had to calm him. He's seen those emails. He's going to fly over there. And I said, no. Yeah, fuck that guy. You know, so, oh, yeah, I got thousands of them. I get hate mail every fucking day. People hate the truth. You know, to tell the truth is hard. You know, in this society, it wasn't in past society, people can't accept the truth because they've been postured and groomed into their whole fallacy false lie. They're styrofoam fake rock mansions, they're fucking fake what, they're pseudo de facto fucking careers, which they do nothing. Shelter, just like the marine biologists. I've learned, they don't do anything. They got jobs and titles. But to do work, they don't work. You say it best when you say, we have to do the work. Well, that's what you and I are doing. We're doing the fucking work. We're doing the Fukushima work. You and I, Jan, you know, she's doing the Fukushima work. Pink, you know, Shane Russell, fucking Patrick Henry, we're doing the fucking work. This isn't 9/11, you know, where they come out, Naomi Wolf, and you know, Chris Hedges comes back after the fact. Oh, by my book, eh? No, we did it in real time as it was unfolding. You and I, we did the fucking
work. In real studios, in real places, in real houses, with real people, not groomed, as you say. This is a real movement. It's grassroots.
Very real.
It's grassroots.
It's solid as earth as it gets. What's more solid as the earth than this? Countering the fucking nuclear mass murdering. I mean, nuclear isn't pollution that's going to be something around. I mean, the Gulf is as evil as the Gulf was, and it's evil what that fucking Gulf did. It'll take hundreds of years. This is nuclearism. This is the wiping out of all of humanity over time and all eternity in some form. Now, who knows what it'll be? We're fucking countering that. What's more loving, spiritual? What is more important than to try to protect her, Mother Earth? That's what we're doing. That's what Abbey was doing. Edward Abbey fought to her. He loved fucking Mother. He understood it was his mother. He got that so hard. He was in symphony. I spoke at my father-in-law's funeral. By the way, I've read a bunch of Abbey's stuff, and they were friends. And I told him, these men knew how to live in symphony with their environment. They weren't soft 300s. They were meaner than fuck. These fuckers would fight you on the top of a fucking hat. They were brutal fucking men. I mean, two tours in fucking Hell's Kitchen in Korea. These fuckers were wicked, mean motherfuckers. But they loved Mother Earth. They were in tune, and they fought for her. It's their mother. I mean, many people don't get it that this fucking global, we live, it's our mother. We're all brothers and sisters, not religiously, because of the jet stream. We're connected. We are all brothers and sisters, and we're all in this fight whether you want to be in it or fucking not. And that's what your art is. That's your series of art, by the way. It's the counter to we're all. You say it, I say it. We all use 32 because Campbell's used 32 cans, the perfect number. Well, we use 33 because it's the imperfect number. Because nuclear fallout is imperfect. And men aren't, and the people that run nuclear fallout are imperfect. And that's the flaw with it, which we said that was the, Abbey said that was the flaw with it then. Men have to still run these fucking things. There's the flaw. Edward Abbey said that. You know, they all said it. Einstein said it. Sokolov said it. Oppenheimer, men still have to run it. We're imperfect creatures. But we don't even try to fucking... Living symphony. We, you know, nature is a horror, Cobain. All, we want So right there, it's Dick Cheney, fucking oligarch. I mean, you think about those creepy motherfuckers. I mean, fracking, fucking just extract any way from her any way you can. For what? For what? The
okay.
Future generation?
All right, now I'm telling you, Abby, as he's coming out, he almost looks like he's got a tear in his eyes. He's listening to you. He's getting a tear in his eyes. He's getting a tear in his eyes. I'm looking at him right now as he's coming out.
Think about that. You know what Abby's did? The number one commercial in the United States. Literally, this is how socially conscious we were. We have men like Edward Abbey about the environment. The number one issue in the United States was littering. There were signs everywhere. If somebody seen somebody even throw a cigarette butt out in Utah, you'd get the fuck beat out of you. There was $1,000 fine in 1970. And think about the logo. The number one ad campaign in America was the Indian with the teardrop running down his cheek.
That's
it was
right.
Constant. We were socially conscious in the 70s before these soft so-called pre-huggers, these fucking calling and having organic and a latte fucking kidnapped our movement. You know, the environmentalists, I love Carol Gallagher, by the way. She fought. She says, Kevin, you talked me out into coming out of retirement, by the way. She's coming out of retirement. She's forgotten more than all of us fucking know. They were there, but they were so few. Under the Cloud, Richard Miller, which she assisted on that book. And I would like to say this to anybody. Abby and Richard Miller knew each other personally. We were fucking buddies. Read Richard Miller's Under the Cloud. Watch that. He was a scientist. Look at the data he compiled. And so it's there. And I think Abby would be, like you said, the teardrop is so perfect. Because they would all cry. I mean, if they come home, I could just see their hands over their face just broke down crying.
It's like the sadness, as this is coming along, there's a profound, profound, profound sadness. And you know, we're in a real shitter. We're in a tough time. We're in a really...
People think you can't. You know how perfectly healthy and strong I was until October 13, 2011?
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck who you are. And by the way, Abby lives in Moab. Okay, that's where they're trying to build the Newcastle nuclear power, which, by the way, I put the stop to that. Our governor, Dirty Herbie, told me to fuck off right to my face. That's how intense I've been with him. With the central line hanging out of my doctor, my doctors are anti-nuclear because they know nuclear causes cancer. But by the way, Moab, to all you people, wake up, fuckers, in southern Utah, it is the cancer capital of the world. Of the world. 300 open-air tests rained over southern Utah. And everybody forgot? Plutonium didn't forget. It's killing more people today than it did in the 50s or the 60s. When you talk about downwinders, you cannot talk in past tense. You have to talk in present tense and in the future for at least 24,500 years. Is the cancer, and that's where Abby lived. Now, Abby, his esophagus went on him. He was pretty young, but you got to realize the guy drank 2 fifths of whiskey a day. You know what his greatest, I love his one quote. He says, I'm an expert in marriage. You know, ask me. He says, I've tried it 7 times. I don't know if it's 6 or 7, but, you know, and by the way, this woman who I know really well, she was at our university the other day, very close friends with Abby. Me and her had a great talk the other day. And, you know, she's awesome. Everybody in Utah knew him. He knew everybody. I mean, he was so connected with people. I mean, keg parties were legal in those days. He'd show up at keg parties. You know, that's the kind of guy he was.
Yeah.
And you just look like some fucking, you know, look like a fucking normal fucking, you know, hillbilly fucking around. You don't know him, you know, scraggy hair, fucking beard, beat up fucking truck, you know, with a fucking pushed up beer can in one hand and a fucking half sip of whiskey. That was normal around here. That's the way Utah works. You know, these people were wilderness lovers, you know, this is before Utah grew up. I don't know, anybody who's never been here. I mean, the landscape in Utah is beyond spectacular. It is, that's what's so sad about it. The most beautiful landscape maybe on Earth across this state. That's why I don't leave. And these fuckers have poisoned it with nuclear fallout. So it's this beautiful thing that's like, I guess it's like a really beautiful female if you don't know anything about it. You know, maybe you're in love with and she's, you know, robbing your bank account. Robbing more than that, robbing your entire future.
Okay, now I want you to have a really good thought because I need, in that, I think you know, I sent you that Abby portrait, pencil portrait, and he's got a shirt with this funny looking thing on it. I'm stuck now. I need a color for the shirt. Because I got this sort of green.
It's gotta be orange, doesn't it?
Yeah, you like the orange idea. Did he wear orange?
The orange is the leukemia color. And orange is a powerful, powerful color. That's why it was picked for leukemia. It is the leukemia color, and I mean you think about he died of esophagus, but all of his group
died of cancer.
Every one of his friends died of cancer. They all died of fucking cancer.
You're seeing it as an orange.
Yeah, I'll tell you a great story. Right here by the pond where I shoot those videos, God, this is long. I was a young hippie. Well, I wouldn't call me a hippie. I had this long blonde hair. I was really tough to get. I was a progressive, but I was an artist. I had this beautiful, crazy blonde hair. And the girls I was hanging around with, I think that's what Abby used to kind of hang around with, the freaking art group, too, because we had all the beautiful girls. The beautiful girls in those days were environmentalists. They had the flowers in their hair. They were the Edie Sedgwick. The beautiful females in Utah were everywhere, and they were hardcore environmentalist chicks. I mean, if you come out, what are these hair straight douchebags like they are now? These girls were spitting their face. They were into the art. They were into the freaking environment. They really did all wear flowers in their hair. So, here's Abby and I over there watching the fireworks show. And Drake, and he's passed out on the fucking blanket. These girls put fucking, wildflowers all over his hair. Why he was passed out. I think it was his wife who actually did it. Whoever that was at the time, he had so many of them. But, wakes up with these flowers in his hair, and he kept them in his hair. He laughed. He fucking thought it was great,
I'm doing the orange. I'm doing the orange.
Read quotes. Wow. His one-liners. I mean, fuck, what wit. What a fucking mind he had. He was a fucking genius.
I'm doing the orange. I'm doing it.
All right. And not only was he a fucking genius, that's what people don't mistake. They're mistaken these so-called people that we look like. Maybe we don't have perfect hair spraying on them. We hijacked the thinking what intelligent was and not intelligent. These songs of people like Abby, they're the brilliant fucking people that have been. Anybody who's pro-war is a fucking moron. I mean, how anti-war he was, of course. I mean, they were all mom guys. His whole crew was fucking mom guys and fucking crazy. Hell's Kitchen's fucking guys. The greatest battles in the fucking, that was his plan. They were fucking peace activists. I mean, and you think about it, what was it about Abbey at his purest core? He was the ultimate humanitarian. He was a fucking humanitarian. Pure. We ought to say, Nelson Mandela, all these guys. Mother Teresa, these people. Yeah, they're great humanitarians and they're one. They weren't fucking Edward Abbey. Edward Abbey was at the core. He was a pure, hardcore, organic, real humanitarian. And he was willing to fucking fight him. He says, that's what I am. I'm not afraid of these fuckers. And that's what we have to be. Not, he didn't get himself thrown in jail. He did it legally. But he did it through literature. He did it through his art, and I'll tell you what, his art was so fucking powerful. His art is so responsible for so much of the, great environmental movement of the 1970s. The environmental movement of the 1970s, this country was a powerhouse. It was gigantic, and then, of course, here come, the 80s, 86, Chernobyl, and that's why I used, by the way, GP, that's why I used I Live to Tell. That was written in 1986, and that was not written for Madonna, I love that movie. I love that song. He wrote that, what's his name, Patrick, wrote that song for the movie in Oregon, for Australia. Here we go. Of course, it's smart. We were born to set this right, the country and western version of Hamlet. There's some room for you. Here's some room for me, and here's some for you. But you must wear your rule of the difference. That's powerful shit. Literature. Edward Abbey, literature.
I think I got him. I think I got him, Kevin. I think I got him. This was I don't know.
I gotta go. It's actually raining. I want to stand out in the rain. It hasn't rained in 100 years. And see if I can get, some of this nuclear rain in my fucking, on my head. See what it does to me.
Kevin, I want to thank you because I think I got him. I got the modern day.
Powerful pain. I can't wait to fucking see it.
Modern day Braveheart.
Your series is incredible.
I'm hoping.
That work is turning out incredible.
I'm hoping to have 16 of them. I'm doing them in duplicates. They're coming out as doubles, and it's part of the process, which is kind of interesting because
we and I have worked on this together the whole time. You know, we used the suit paintings. We started this out with sketches hanging on the clothesline. I used my cloth ones. You used your drawings, and you know, people that show up on the thing. It's just, you know, we're trying to use people that. First of all, you have people who really make a difference in a really pure, organic way, like Abbey.
Modern day Braveheart.
I'm really excited about it.
Modern day Braveheart. Yeah. I had that impulse on the blue and the black and the.
Isn't that amazing?
Modern day, and I got him a orange shirt. I got the orange shirt, and I got him.
Go ahead.
I got him now. I think I got him. It took I think it was about a half an hour. This is one of my. Faster paintings because I was trying to keep up with you. As you're going on and on, and you're ratcheting up.
I don't know what to say about this because, you know, people think I go on and on. Yeah, fucking idiot, I go on and on because you know what? We've been smashed down. Our voice hasn't been able to be heard for 30, 40 fucking years.
That's right.
We need to go on and on. What do we all say? I love people that fucking talk a lot. He says, they're the fucking best. That's what he always aspired to be. That's the only true thing you ever see. He really honestly did want to be a talk show host. And he understood that people like us, we didn't have a voice. People won't listen to us because we're a rage against the machine.
Yeah, and this is perfect because as you were talking, I was getting animated and I was putting it together and I think it's working. You know, sometimes in a painting, you hit it, you don't hit it, you never know. But I think this really worked, Kevin. I like it. And
by the way, anybody's on this fucking list, and if they don't like it, who gives a fuck, number one? fuck, we don't ask. I mean, fuck, why would we? But I can guarantee you, fucking Edward Addy, like I said, I knew him, and he loved me, by the way, when I was a heathen. He used to shake his fucking head at me. So did, you know, his whole clan used to shake their head out of me and say, what the fuck, this kid? You know? He would hug us. I guarantee he would hug us.
You know, Kevin, in all of this tribulation and difficulty, we got to find somewhere within each other the joy, the pleasure. It's what I talk about.
I love this. I have so much joy in all this because it's the art, and art makes me happy.
There you go.
Visual art, my videos. When I see, I tell my daughters all the time, they can take everything in the fucking world from me. I walk into the fucking moment, and I stand in front of that painting with the papa painted, that little boy with the horse. That's right where I go. My fucking mind races in so much fucking joy just looking at it. When I look at beautiful fucking great art, and I can identify fucking art. That's why I identified you. I mean, I love people to try to fucking, you know, get into fucking bed with me on false ignorance, and I don't fuck no. Because I can see your art's powerful shit. Really powerful.
Kevin, this is I think the basis of our cooperation is that we have a fundamental feeling of wanting to enjoy each other and encouraging each other in the best parts of us. It's not like complaining and fucking sitting around blah blah blah.
Anger.
Yeah.
Poetry.
This
poetry
exactly.
Is beautiful.
Exactly. And this is what people don't understand. This the pleasure, the joy in this makes you want
to
live.
Don't understand it. Go watch fucking Braveheart. Go watch Seabiscuit. I make my kids watch Seabiscuit every time they get depressed.
Nice.
I mean, it's poetry. Poetry is hard, it's tough, it's strong, but the one component that our art has that gives me so much joy, the truth.
Yeah.
It's simply the fucking truth.
Beautiful, beautiful.
And the truth is righteousness. This is righteousness. Not some religious kidnap fucking organized religion. Organized religion. Organized religion in every fucking way. Thomas Jefferson, the fucking root of all evil is organized religion. Oh, they got it back then.
Yeah, we're connecting on a level that's primeval. It's sort of like sitting around the campfire and feeling the absolute exaltation. You look up into the night sky and you see the stars, and it's that kind of a feeling. You know, you're
that's
with
exactly
each other.
That's exactly what Abbey did every night of his life. You know, that's what they did. They sat in the desert and they camped and they looked at the stars, and that's what he came up with his great writing. That's what they did every night. They sat around the campfire, looked at the stars, drank, listened to the fucking coyotes fucking howl. That's what he did his whole fucking life. And he wrote next to the campfire like so many fucking great Western artists did.
Yeah.
You know, he might have been from Pennsylvania, but he was so Utah. Oh, he was so fucking Utah, you know.
You know, you realize, of course, that the joy, this primeval joy, has been extracted from the art these days. It's also clinical. It's also completely contrived. There is no joy left in it. It's like, what is it? What the hell are we looking at? Sticks and feathers on the floor. I don't know what the hell. The joy is gone.
I always put my thumbprint on American culture. That's why I use so many music, and I use lyrics, and I use a poster of Fleetwood Mac, and another Utah girl, by the way, Stephen Nick, and Bruce, you know, and I use that because the thumbprint, think about what music's been in the last 20 years. It's all contrived. It's all corporate. It's contrived. There's nothing organic. That's why it's so shitty. Same with art. It's all the same. There is no fucking art. Corporate fucking contrived. Contrived fucking art is, it will never be art. And you got these, like you call it fucking interior decorators for oligarchs. But that ain't art. It's nothing close to it. It's the opposite of art. It's completely the opposite of art.
The joy is gone. The joy is gone.
We're putting the joy back into it.
We're putting the joy back in.
That is joy. That's joy. It's the poetry of the anger is beautiful. It's joyful. And let me say this. I talked to one of my doctors yesterday. He says, Kevin, we teach de novo at the university now in the nursing school. And the one of my nurses, she's in the class. She piped her. She says, yeah, Kevin, you do know that we teach that 90% of people that get de novo like I had, which is leukemia presenting in a tumor, 90% are dead in 120 days.
Wow.
90%. And my daughter says, you know you're alive. And so think about my poetry of anger as I've gone along this. I'm alive.
Yeah.
Now, what's kept me alive?
Yeah.
Just what you just said. What you said.
Yeah.
The beauty, the joy, the truth, the art of it. That's why I'm alive. That's the only reason I'm alive.
And they've tried to hijack...
Everybody's prayers, again, across social media. You know how many people pray for me?
Yeah.
You know what people really believed in me and fought for me? Those people, and that power, across social media, across YouTube land, the whole world, they did seances on beaches for me. They saved my life because that's the truth. It's the purity of righteousness. You know, they wanted me to live, so I lived.
And I think we're, like I feel about myself, that if I can generate this feeling, like we talked about this Lorna Too Funky doing the video, inspiring people to feel the joy back in themselves. She said that she hasn't been inspired this way for a long time, and I think this is so important to try and bring this out in people again. And let
now,
them...
we need to make sure we tell this to everybody when it comes to post-ignorance. Now, free radicals are a different situation. Free radicals, like you said, delivery system. Free radicals, free radicals. Post-ignorance is post-ignorance.
Right.
But in regards to post-ignorance, I can't speak for free radicals. That's you.
That's
post-ignorance
right.
Post-ignorance is me.
That's
we
right.
We can talk about it, but in the case of post-ignorance, I would say this to all artists. I don't give a fuck what it looks like. I mean, if you look at my one I did with the throwing the powder on the fucking when painting with the suit, how ugly is that? How fucked up was that painting? That's what, I mean, who cares what it looks like? Oh, it looks like a child. It looks like, that's what we want. We want to go back to our core. Her painting, you know, you look at, she did those rough sketches with just those stick figures of those two people standing. This means it's metaphors. And I've read, you've heard me read it over and over, my definition of post-ignorance. Boy, she got it. Oh, who gives a fuck what it looks like?
Yeah.
It's what it says.
It's, what I say, this is really interesting. This people should really pay attention to this because most, if not everything, is intent. So if your intent is to build something that is going to carry us into the next level of our abilities, our consciousness, the intent behind the work, the intent, when you put that soup onto that metal thing, it is an exaltation of brilliance and understanding where we are. It's connected to where we are. It's not some hypothetical idiosyncratic expression. It's exactly where we are. This is the nature of art, and people don't understand this. They say it's like my kid could do it. I get this all the time. You know, people come in my studio and say, oh yeah, my kid could do this. Well, I say to them, you have a very low opinion of your children. That's what I say.
Well, the thing is, too, and like I said, because all they're looking at is what it looks like.
Yeah.
They're not fucking looking into, like you said, the consciousness. That's what art is. Isn't that what art is? I mean, you think about it, when you sit down and draw and paint, I don't care if you're the shittiest or the best artist in the world. You're really drawn out of your subconscious. So when it draws out of the subconscious, you let it go. It says everything about the artist. It's a blotter test, not just for us, but the people looking at it. How fucked up is the purple? It's a blotter test. That person's fucked up. They said the same thing about fucking Monet. I mean, come on, you know. It'll be, Monet went from fucking what he was to be a... They allowed him to drape the only bitches going into Paris and fucking women.
Yeah.
You know, think about that. An artist is going to be able to fucking drape the fucking Brooklyn Bridge and fucking women, shut down commerce for and people all over. It's different now. Oh, it ain't fucking different now. No, it's not. The fucking center of the economic world was Paris, like New York is now. It's so fucking different. And people fucking accused him of finger paintings in the early days.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't get the meaning, but over time, people fucking get the meaning. Now, I don't get worried, Thomas, that there aren't people making the art. What I get worried is people interpreting the art. You always have certain groups in Paris and certain people that, even though they may have been oligarchs and rich, their children or somebody broke across and could identify and interpret their art. Peggy Guggenheim and on and on and on. Where the fuck are they?
Yeah. Yeah, we need the Guggenheims to come on board. We need the Guggenheims.
Someone who can identify some kind. I don't give a fuck if you're up, my art, some.
Yeah.
Somebody, I can't find any art who's got any fucking meaning.
Yeah.
I mean, I look at reflectionary art, which I term contemporary art is under reflectionary. As post-ignorance, I say, Popism died 3/11/11. Now, they would say, oh, Popism died a long time. No, also Popism come out of it. Then Neo-Popism come out of it. But it's still Popism. And it fucking died. And post-ignorance is the counter to all of that. It's just what the word says. Post-ignorance is counter-ignorance. If Warhol was alive, you know, as he was doing his Popism with Marilyn Monroe, with, you know, Elvis, with all these Edie Sedgwick, it's not that now. I mean, even though he was making mockery of it all, he was choosing these incredible, brilliant, sexual, amazing fucking people in their own right, incredible artists in film and that. Now look what we have. That's fucked. The modern day fucking popism creature compared to Edie Sedgwick, compared to Elvis Presley, compared to Marilyn Monroe, that's like comparing a fucking, a Bugatti to a 1972 Pinto.
It's the girl with the tongue. It's the girl with...
I think if he wouldn't have died, Ackermann, I think if Warhol would not have died, this would have never continued. I think he would have put a stop to this, to his art.
Yeah.
But nobody picked it up, and these people that picked up after Warhol, you know, the name made the beautiful drawing of American Graffiti, that album cover. By the way, I'm going to go to that building when you and I are there.
Yeah.
And he's a Warhol protege.
Oh, I'm looking forward for you to give me a little bit of a tour of where you're walking around down there.
We'll get into some art while we're there, some amazing fucking art.
And anybody
you know,
want...
When he wrote the song with the tail one, you know, American Physical Graffiti, that album cover is a brilliant, 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 amazing piece of art.
And Kevin, people can come along. People can come along. It's not...
Well, they're going to come along.
Yeah.
We have a lot of people that are showing up.
Okay.
And we're not going to talk just about art. We're not going to talk just about culture. We're going to talk about why and how we put a stop to nuclearism.
Yeah.
You know, really.
That's what it's all about. That's what it's about. That's what it is. It's
intellectually immoral.
Yeah. It's the Blue Edward Abbey, how to stop this nuclearism. That's what it's all about. That's what it's about. I got it.
I can't wait to see it.
I nailed him. Thanks, Kevin. I nailed him. And I'll finish him off.
I really do love your work. I really appreciate everything.
We're doing it. We're doing it. Okay. Bye.